Hey everybody, Kevin at Woodcraft here, and today we're going to talk about cutting boards. Cutting boards are a super simple project that make a great introduction to woodworking for beginners. But for the more experienced woodworker, they're also a great way to use up scrap wood, try out new techniques, experiment with that new tool you just got, or get creative. Now this isn't going to be a how-to video. Instead, we're going to focus on topics such as wood selection, grain orientation, finish options, and things like that. So the next time you go to make a cutting board, you'll be well-informed and you can make the best one you've ever made. Wood has some unique properties that make it more suitable for cutting boards than other materials. It's more impact-resistant, it's gentler on your knives, and it has natural antibacterial properties that make it more sanitary. Plus, it's pretty, and you can brag to everybody that sees it that you're the one who made it. Next, we're going to talk wood selection. For the most part, these are more guidelines than rules, but there's some things you should think about, and there's some woods that you definitely want to stay away from. You want wood that's hard, but not too hard. So you want to stay away from your soft woods, like your firs and your pines. I know a lot of beginner woodworkers like to work with construction lumber from the big box stores. This is not one of those projects. You want good quality hardwoods. On the other end of that spectrum, you want to stay away from your super hardwoods, like your lignum vitaes, your snake woods, your ironwoods, and your catalogs. They're going to be too hard, they're really hard to work with, and they're going to dull your knives faster. You've got to go with that sweet spot in the middle, things like your maples, your cherries, your walnuts. If you want to add a little splash of color, you've got your purple heart, your red heart, your padauk, your yellow heart, things like that. But hardness isn't the only thing to consider. You want to stick with your closed pore, tight grain woods. Things like oak and ash with their open pore structure aren't recommended because those open pores can soak up moisture and lead to your cutting board warping, mold growth, or stains. I'd personally stay away from anything with bug holes just because you don't want food or bacteria getting down in those holes. And you definitely want to stay away from anything spalted. For those of you unfamiliar, spalt is a fungus that grows in the wood. And while it can be super pretty, it's definitely not food safe. When people talk about types or styles of cutting boards, typically they're referencing either edge grain cutting boards or end grain cutting boards, sometimes referred to as butcher blocks. But to complicate things a little bit further, I'm going to throw in a third category and say face grain cutting boards. When you're looking at a board, you have your wide open face grain, your smaller edge grain, and your end grain. And these all have different properties and characteristics that lend themselves to certain cutting board applications. Face grain is what you first see when you look at a board. It's got a wide surface area, so that's where you're going to see the most figure or pattern in the wood. Face grain cutting boards are arguably the easiest kind to make. If I wanted to, I could take this board, cut on it, and it would be a cutting board. But where's the fun in that? Because of the wide surface area and the continuous grain pattern, this is going to show your knife marks the most. I would reserve them for things like cheese slicers that have a dedicated cutting area, things like charcuterie boards, and more decorative serving trays like this football board. You can see this is mostly face grain with a little bit of maple edge grain for the details. Edge grain cutting boards are by far the most common because they reach a nice compromise between durability and ease of construction. They take a lot less effort to make than end grain boards, so they're typically cheaper. You can use lots of different varieties of wood and make it very interesting, and they're a great way to use up scraps. All of the pieces for this board came out of that scrap bin over there. Because you're gluing up a bunch of strips, they do require a little bit more effort than face grain boards, but there's not a whole lot. With edge grain cutting boards, you can still see some figure in the woods, although it won't be as much as with your face grain. Lastly, we have end grain cutting boards. These take the most time and effort to make, so they're typically more expensive. However, I wouldn't call them difficult. If you're doing a lot of cutting and chopping, this is the type of board you want because the fibers of the wood are oriented up and down, so they're very soft and gentle on your knives, and it won't show knife marks nearly as easily as your edge grain or your face grain. An important thing to mention here is you don't want to mix your end grain and your edge grain. They're going to get wet and dry, and you're going to have some wood movement. The wood on your end grain cutting board is going to move differently than your edge grain cutting board, and if you mix them together, you could see cracks, your board might fall apart, and it's just not going to last as long. We have our three basic wood glues here, your Type-On 1, 2, and 3. Because we're talking about cutting boards, you're going to have to wash them at some point. Now, you never want to stick your wood cutting board in the dishwasher or let it soak in water, but at some point it's going to get wet. So Typon 1 is out. A lot of people say you can get away with the water resistance of Typon 2, but in my house, and if you're selling your boards or giving them to someone else, you never know what's going to happen. So I only ever recommend waterproof Typon 3. Typically, your cutting boards are going to see a lot of abuse. So you might think you want a super durable film finish that's going to protect the wood. But that's wrong. You want to actually cut on the wood and not on a finish. So, sorry, Armor Seal, you're my favorite, but you're out. Now, if you're doing something more like a cheese slicer or a charcuterie board or a serving tray, one of the more decorative options that's not actually going to see knife cuts, you could probably get away with something like the General Finish's wood bowl finish. Your cutting board is constantly getting used and washed, and it's going to wear down that finish very quickly. So we need something that's easy to apply and easy to reapply. We're going to go with a non-drying oil. So that's not your typical boiled linseed oil or your tung oil that you usually use as a wood finish. But you also don't want to use a vegetable oil, an olive oil, things like that, because those can go rancid. We need to go with a stable, food-safe mineral oil that won't dry or go rancid. The other thing you can use on your board for added liquid protection is beeswax. I've only ever used the Howard's cutting board oil and the Butcher Block conditioner. However, there are some other recommendations out there. Typically, I'll do 2 coats of the cutting board oil and then 2 coats of the Butcher Block conditioner. However, things like your end grain cutting board, they're going to soak up a lot of oil, so you may need to apply more. If you are more of a beginner or have never done a cutting board and you aren't quite sure how to get started, Woodcraft offers a variety of cutting board kits that make it super simple. All you have to do is glue and clamp these together, but they're more of a launching pad, so you can add different woods, do different edge treatments. You can still make this your own. If you don't want to do a simple cutting board, you want to step it up a little bit, we have a Make Your Own Cutting Board book by David Picciuto. This has some great ideas and how-to instructions on some really interesting cutting boards. Well, I think that pretty much exhausts my knowledge of cutting boards. As always, if you have any questions, feel free to leave a comment below. And if you want to get your hands on anything you saw in this video, head over to your local Woodcraft store or online to woodcraft.com.